Well, good morning at this very early hour. I'm impressed everyone's turned out at 8 a.m. Wow. So I've got a fairly short talk today. I want to talk about something that I'm quite passionate about, and it's fundamentally about engaging constructively with researchers, but also not making bold claims that you can't substantiate. And we're actually going through a vulnerability disclosure just this very morning with a vendor that has effectively stonewalled us and told us that everything that we've claimed and discovered is wrong and not factually correct. Yet we have the evidence to back it up. But the vendor is sticking to their ground and saying, hey, no, you're all wrong. So I'm going to start. Who am I? I am a security researcher. I work with a group of pen testers, about 100 of us, and we do a lot of work on embedded systems. So we're really into things like IoT, so hardware, software, firmware, reverse engineering. But if you do get a chance, come and find us in the sandbox a little later, because we do a lot of work in aviation and avionics. So we've got a flight simulator running, and we're showing how you can do some cool stuff with aviation security. Come and have a fly of our flight sim. It's quite good fun. You've probably seen some of our work in the past. You might remember Samsung smart TVs. Do you remember they were shown a few years ago to be listening to you? That was our work. And we also showed that your voice data was being sent overseas for decoding from voice into text, which is kind of creepy, right? I'd really like to know that my personal data, my voice, is going to stay within country. You may also remember a good few years ago now, we started looking at Samsung's smart refrigerator. Now, this is awesome. Great big refrigerator with a big screen on the door and a camera on the inside. So you could see what was inside your refrigerator from the outside. I don't know why you just couldn't open the door, but hey. So there's lots of crazy things we've looked at. Now, one of these stories that I really quite enjoy, one of the very first forays we ever did into embedded system security was this little smart dolly. This is my friend Kayla. Now, could I have a show of hands? Who knows about my friend Kayla? Anybody? Only one or two of you. Wow, okay. So she's awesome. Over 5 years ago now, we started looking at the security of this talking dolly. And we found some fairly concerning security flaws with her. She's interactive. She has a microphone and a speaker, and she talks to a smartphone over Bluetooth. Now, microphone, speaker, Bluetooth, yes, she is effectively a Bluetooth headset. So you can pair her to your cell phone and make calls on the dolly if you wish. Though you do get some very weird looks when you do that. Particularly when you're driving, but anyway. Now, there were all sorts of security vulnerabilities within her. The first and most serious is the Bluetooth connection to your smartphone had no pin on it, which meant that anyone in Bluetooth range, so 30, 40 yards maybe, so your next door neighbor or someone on the street outside, could connect to the microphone in the dolly and spy on you. And even more creepy, they could talk to your children through the speaker. So this dolly became a spy bug in your house. And we found that really distasteful. However, we wanted to have some fun with her. So we started looking at the way that she processed speech. And we discovered some vulnerabilities in a SQL-like database in the smartphone application that we could tamper with. And as a result of which, we can now make her swear like a docker. I've recorded her for your entertainment. Here she
Hello.
Is. Bear with me, she comes up in a moment.
Hey, calm down, or I will kick the shit out of you.
She is so rude. But anyway, the reason why I brought this subject up, because it's an old piece of research, is that more recently, there's been real progress in embedded systems and IoT security. So the California Senate published Bill 327. It was ratified and written into law, became effective Jan 1st this year. We now have consumer protection regulation mandating reasonable security features. And what I was super proud about was the fact that the senator that introduced the bill cited the work on my friend Kayla as the catalyst behind it. So this one swearing doll has led to laws to make security better for all of us. And I'm kind of proud of that. Anyway, let's move on to the real subject of today's talk. I want to talk today about hardware crypto wallets. Anyone got any cryptocurrency? Not so many. If you wanted to, it'd be great. And the big problem that keeps coming up with cryptocurrency is not so much actually the blockchains that it relies on, but more actually the user interface. We've seen people have crypto coins stolen, primarily through simple basic security issues, basic security hygiene, either the operators not thinking about security properly, or the users not looking after their seed and passphrases, which causes all sorts of problems. So there's been some opportunities in the market and some really interesting crypto wallets, so Ledger, Trezor, a couple of the best-known brands, where you can safely store your keys and safely sign transactions. So you're not reliant on the user remembering a crazy password or reusing the same password somewhere else. But this talk is not about those. It's not about those because actually these two vendors have had some security vulnerabilities in their time, but they responded really well to researchers. They embraced the researcher, they took action, they fixed it, they thanked the researcher. Anyone can have problems. It's how you deal with them is what this talk is about. I want to introduce the Bitfi. And now, another show of hands, please. Who has heard of the Bitfi? Wow, not so many of you. Good. This had a lot of coverage last year. And Bitfi manufactures the world's first and only completely unhackable hardware wallet. Now, what's the big hot word in there, right? They said it was unhackable. Now, that is a huge claim to make, right? Does anyone here think they're unhackable? I sure don't. Making a statement like that is really quite interesting. And I don't know if you saw that Menlo Security made a statement yesterday. They claimed 100% security, and they put $1 million warranty on their product. I thought that was really brave. I really did, because they're saying they're completely effectively unhackable. Wow. So we took interest in this. Unhackable, big claim. And then we started digging deeper and discovered a really interesting character who's involved in this. Everyone come across John McAfee? Wow, he is quite a character. If you don't follow him, do. He has some really interesting conversations, including ones about snorting bath salts. Yes. McAfee became involved in Bitfi. We're not entirely sure of his direct involvement. He may have been paid, he may have been given stock, but he started promoting the Bitfi actively to his network of cryptocurrency fans. And then things got really interesting. They said, it's unhackable, and we're going to put up a $100,000 bounty if anyone hacks it. Like, right. So I started gathering a team, started talking to the team, said, right, $100,000. Anyone interested in that? Hell yeah. It's unhackable. Let's have a go. Let's see what we can do. Let's put a team together. We started reviewing some of their content. First thing they said, your private keys are never stored anywhere except your brain. This is a brain wallet. So it's using a passphrase and seed to secure the keys on the hardware device. This is interesting. We started reading up more. We started looking at how the bounty was proposed, $100,000. We had to spend $50 on a Bitfi. Hey, we're fine with that. That's no problem. If you successfully compromise the wallet and get the coins out, they'll make a payment of $100,000. Sounds simple, right? This is right up our street. It is embedded system security. It's looking at cryptography and more. And then things started to go a bit strange. They then announced that the bounty program is not intended to help them identify security vulnerabilities. What the heck is a bounty program if it's not for identifying security vulnerabilities? Since we already believe our security is absolute. Wow, that's crazy. So this is when we started getting interested. They claimed that Bitfi being unhackable was the same as one very specific attack type. And I'm sure when you're doing your threat modeling, you're thinking about lots of different attack types. But yet, it was only one attack that was eligible for the bounty. So we ordered one. We got hold of one. And on the back of the box, we saw some interesting claims. A hardware wallet with a firmware-encrypted CPU. Now, I've been involved in embedded system security for over 10 years. I've never come across a firmware-encrypted CPU. And I'm sure one of the other things you're very familiar with is the requirement for entropy. You need to seed your cryptographic operations with a good, strong seed. And the seed that the Bitfi came with was a six-sided die. Not perhaps the best way to seed your crypto. So people started asking questions of John McAfee. So how did it work if there was nothing on the device, if your keys weren't stored on there, how were they stored and how did the system work? And Mr. McAfee said, hey, there is no memory to hack. There's no data. Okay. There's nothing sensitive other than the information in your head. There's no memory on the device. Am I going, I don't know many hardware devices that don't have any memory at all. Maybe some of you do, I don't. So we ordered one and started reverse engineering it to see what we could find. Now, I don't know if you saw just there, there's something on the left there, a 4C eMMC, otherwise known as 8 gigabyte RAM chip. So we put this to John and said, you just said in your tweets that there's no memory. And we say he comes back and said, there is no RAM. Like, well, hang on a minute, what was that? This can't be hacked. There's no software on the device and there's no memory. You can't do a software hack because there's no software. How does the device work? There has to be some software. There's nothing that will give you in the hardware that will give you the passphrase. So we sent him that picture. John, what is that? That's RAM, right? But you said there was no RAM in the device, but we opened it up and we found 8 gigabytes of RAM. Okay, so we put it to him. When I say there's no memory on Bitfi, I'm talking about the storage. Obviously there's RAM, but the RAM is devoid of meaningful data. Okay, so we're getting physical evidence that doesn't back up what we're being told. So we're now getting more and more interested. And John starts interacting more and more aggressively on Twitter, which is fun. So we get a hold of one. It's only $120. It's much more costly to manufacture than ordinary hardware wallets. Wow, this must be some really heavy duty hardware. We really want to know what they're doing that's different and unique. But they price it affordably. $120, much more costly to make. So we took it apart. It's a MediaTek MT6580 cell phone. Costly to make. You can buy these in bulk for around $10 a piece. It's a cell phone. So we put this to him. He said, no, it's absolutely not a cell phone, because all cell phones are hackable. Well, okay. Fine. It's definitely not a cell phone. So we took this a little bit further. So we got the back off. There's the back, that's great. There's the battery, and there's not the SIM holder. So it can't be a cell phone. On their own website, they describe it as a smartphone in the image they named it. And even in the manual, they talk about the phone returning to the interface. It's not a cell phone, right? Absolutely not a cell phone. And then Bitfi disowned John McAfee publicly. We can't control Mr. McAfee. We'll only maintain constructive engagement with anyone on social media. Wow. So this is the guy who's been paid big bucks to promote this device. And actually all he's really doing is antagonizing security researchers and burning their public profile. Uncontrollable. This is a story of how to get your public profile wrong. So we started going a bit further. Remember, this is a really expensive custom hardware that's really a MediaTek phone. And what about the whole shoulder surfing attack? When you're tapping your seed and passphrase, surely someone could look over your shoulder and have a look. He said, no, it's got an extremely narrow viewing angle. Okay, so we took one at about 75 degrees and we could read the text just fine. What narrow viewing angle? Then we found another crypto shill who was trying to point out that no, you definitely couldn't see it, and failed to take account of the fact that Twitter, you can quite easily take that image and then modify the contrast and brightness, and we recovered the crypto shill's seed and passphrase through exactly the tack that we suggested we could do. Crazy, right? So we have utterly dismantled all their claims about being amazing, secure, custom technology. How did we hack it? Now, I want to make it really clear at this point. This was a team effort. Nearly 30 different people were involved in this piece of work. It was led by one of my colleagues, a guy called Cyber Gibbons. I strongly recommend you follow him on Twitter. He is full of really, really interesting research. We also worked with a guy called Ryan Castellucci, who is an expert in crypto operations, and a guy called Salim Rashid, who is, did some of the original work on the Ledger and Trezor crypto wallets. But there are many, many other people, including myself, who are involved in some of this. So the first attack, and we found 5 different attacks in the end, all using completely different techniques, was to look at I2C. Now, I2C is the protocol that's typically used to take data from the screen digitizer and pass it into the MCU. So it's going to be tracking the movement in your finger. So if you're tapping in a seed and passphrase, that's what sends the data. Now, this is typically going to be a supply chain attack. We're talking about a crypto wallet looking after crypto seeds and passwords, so it's going to have valuable data on there. Let's think about the evil maid or the supply chain problem. Already, we discovered some weirdness. We bought one of these devices, and the serial number on the outside of the box was different to the serial number on the inside. They clearly have some supply chain problems already. If I can get into that supply chain at factory, tamper, I can do stuff. So this is where I2C fits in. Takes from the capacitive touchscreen, takes the digitizer, and the data then passed back to the MCU, I2C. Plain text, unencrypted. If you can then tamper or get access to the I2C interface, which you can see just there, a couple of wires on the back, you can now intercept the position of the finger on the screen and recover the seed and passphrase. Now, in order to make this effective, you probably need to intercept it in the supply chain, cut down the battery size, put a smaller battery in, put in a small additional SIM card and 3G data SIM, and you could potentially backdoor that device over ITC and recover people's seeds remotely. That was fun. The next place we went was doing it with physical access to the phone, but only for a very short period of time. And this attack worked over USB, so it worked over the charging cable, the data cable, into the bottom of the device. So with about 15 seconds of access to anyone's Bitfi, we could recover the keys. So remember, it's a MediaTek cell phone, and one of the challenges is with the MediaTek cell phone, the 6580 doesn't have a locked bootloader, which means we can root it on the fly over USB. Completely the wrong choice of device to do security. That got us to dump the file system with a little bit of fun. We could then root it immediately over USB, so meant we could run Doom on it. Now, I've got full and complete access to the device at this point. Something else we did as well. Because we were being antagonized by Bitfi and John McAfee, we didn't want to reveal at this stage that it was a USB-based attack. So we took the back off and put some wires on the back with a little bit of sticky tape. They don't actually do anything, but it confused Bitfi. So it wasn't actually intended to do anything. The attack was over USB. You did not need to have the back over open. Next place, when you're using your Bitfi to sign a transaction, there'll be an interface online with the Bitfi backend, allowing you to correctly sign transactions. So what we wanted to do was see if we could intercept and man the middle of those transactions. So, we put this to Bitfi, as did several others, and this is their response saying why man-in-the-middle wouldn't work. So fine, they were suggesting they had decent certificate pinning, they had decent cryptography on the interaction between the Bitfi backend. Their challenge was if we tampered with any of that, it would balk out, it would reject the transaction, and the funds would be safe. Yeah, that kind of didn't work so well. There is the Bitfi, it's version 89, which was the current firmware. It booted, as we were expecting. Saw it connecting outbound, unsurprisingly, to Bitfi. Yep, got Bitfi, fantastic. Bit of Wireshark. We could strip the SSL pinning. We could tamper with transactions in real time. To prove it, got a little video. That is a transaction going for signing. We could intercept it. We could then modify the data on the fly and send any amount of funds to any wallet we wanted. Anywhere, on the fly. To prove it, a little video here. So we're entering our phrase there. It takes a little while to enter, so we'll run through that quickly. That's the seed and passphrase come through. Man in the middle, over Wi-Fi, and recovered the crypto seed and passphrase. We won. So the device that wasn't supposed to allow interception and man in the middle was completely vulnerable to it. We could send that data anywhere we wanted. But finally, the attack we really wanted to do was cold boot. So this was the original term of the $100,000 bounty prize that they announced. Now, in the process of this disastrous response to security researchers, they actually upped the game. They upped the game to $250,000 bounty if anyone could successfully achieve the terms of their bounty. Their bounty was they took their Bitfi, they shipped it to the researcher, and the researcher had to recover the keys. And what we needed to have in order to make that happen was a cold boot attack, because the device would be powered off for a period of time whilst it was being shipped, whilst it was in transit to us. So we needed cold boot. So from a powered off Bitfi, we need to be able to recover keys. And this was finally succeeded by Salim Rashid. I'll turn the audio off on that one. One of the guys who was putting this together showed after a period of time. Cold boot, device received, it's been in transit for several days, memory is degrading, but because Bitfi weren't clearing memory after use, it meant we could successfully recover the keys and passphrase. Give that a moment, here it comes, and there we go. We've now done a full cold boot attack against this MediaTek cell phone that's really a cryptocurrency wallet, and we've now successfully met the terms of the bounty. The $250,000 bounty. Now, as a group, we'd already decided that we're going to donate that to charity, because I think of the interaction, I think it was the right thing to do. We were going to make a charitable donation of the full amount. And instead, that happened. Wow. So, were we really expecting the bounty to pay? After a few days of interacting with Bitfi, I think we knew that they weren't ever going to give us the money. But there was still a chance of it. I think we very quickly realized that we were dealing with people who were just making outrageous claims, maybe in the quest to get some good publicity, some good media attention. Unhackable got a lot of attention. But actually, when it came to it, they weren't really ever planning to pay out the cash, which is a real shame, because I think it would have been a nice donation. Over a period of time after this, Bitfi then did slowly start to accept that there was a challenge. Is that, yes, their keys did remain in RAM. There was RAM on the device. It did persist. They still stuck to their guns, though. If someone does a very quick memory extraction, you might see the keys. But it doesn't matter how long the keys stay in there. If a cold boot attack works and they don't actively release memory and clear it down, those keys are cached for a long period of time. They still, several weeks after the attack, didn't truly understand exactly what we'd done and how we'd do it. They still stuck to their guns. When you restart the device, it wipes the RAM clean. If you don't actively deal with RAM management, if you don't actively clear it down, there is always going to be forensically recoverable data there. And in the case of crypto passphrases and seeds, that is really, really important. And then things got a bit weird. Then they started threatening us, which was kind of odd. So their social media actively threatened us, which kind of spooked us a little bit. But fortunately, the whole cyber industry rocked up and supported us publicly, which is great. And John McAfee's kind of last words on this, clearly, I think he might have been snorting some more bath salts because autocorrect got a bit mad there. No one got a penny from the wallet. All the hack claims are meaningless. No one came close to taking the coins from the wallet. Well, which bit of what we did didn't satisfy that? We took coins from the wallet. We satisfied the bounty, but they didn't pay out. So then he asked if we'd like to meet. And I don't know about you, but in Britain, we're kind of a bit more nervous around guns. And he just tweeted he'd taken a delivery of custom M4s. Well, I don't know. I didn't particularly fancy flying all the way over to his ranch to meet him, particularly as he'd tweeted a few days earlier about waking up in a dream and picking up a gun and start shooting it randomly at his house. Thought, you know what? We'll just stay away from that one. So this all happened on the run-up to Black Hat 2018. And whilst the awards categories had already been announced and the contenders had been announced, this all blew up on pretty much the Monday before Black Hat. And I was super proud to receive a Pwning Award on Bitfi's behalf for the lamest vendor response. So we went to Vegas and collected that on behalf of the team and lucky John McAfee. But then something really weird happened. Their social media team, nearly 11 months later, middle of last year, started getting a bit crazy again and started denying and decrying what we found and trying to make these unhackable claims all over again. And I don't know if they did it intentionally or not, but they did it just on the run-up to Black Hat 2019 all over again. And for the very first time in the history of the Pony Awards, the same vendor won the same award twice. It's never happened before. That is my colleague Cyber Gibbons doing his acceptance speech. And the guy on the right there, you actually know him. That's Charlie Miller of the Jeep Hack fame. I don't know quite what he was doing there, but he looked pretty cool. So we collected the very first time Pony has ever been awarded twice, which I'm kind of proud of. Now, a little bit of advice around the subject of hardware security is, number one, I hope what you take from this is you never ever claim something is infallible. Never use the word unhackable. It's not a good place to be. If you're developing hardware, if you're developing an embedded system, please, please start by choosing the right base hardware at the very beginning. We consult extensively in embedded systems. And so often, organizations come to us down the line, 3-6 months into development. And right, what's your base hardware? And they've chosen a hardware module that doesn't have a trusted execution environment, doesn't have a source of entropy, doesn't have secure storage. The bootloaders are unlocked by default. There's no code readout protection bypass. There's all these crazy things that people get wrong by choosing the wrong hardware early on. So please, take advice right at the beginning of any hardware project so you can get experts to point you in the right direction of the right MCUs, of the right flash types, the right protocols to use right at the beginning so you don't make really expensive mistakes. Once you're prototyping, it's hard to reverse out of a hardware, poor hardware choice. Make sure you've got access to the tool chain as well. If you don't have access to the tool chain, you don't know what's going on your systems. When you're specifying software dev, so what Bitfi did wrong is they used people who didn't really understand good firmware security. They didn't understand how to do cryptographic operations properly. So if you're specifying outsourced development, put it into your contract. Get your procurement team to embed OWASP, for example, in your procurement contracts so you can guarantee you're going to get good, quality, well-written code. Ask for evidence of a secure development lifecycle, because if the following one, you've got a much better chance of your code being good. But please, if you take one thing away from this, get help right at the beginning. Don't end up in a dead end with a bit of hardware that doesn't do what you need it to do, that can't back you out and do security properly, because that's really expensive to get out of. I do strongly recommend you set up a bug bounty program, but don't do it the way that Bitfi did it. Don't make a great big claim about $100,000 and not really do bug bounty properly. Do it, primarily so researchers can get access to you quickly and get that communication right into your security team so they can respond fast. But I also say don't rely on bug bounty as the only way of doing security. It's really important that you have bug bounty there so researchers can get you, but it's also super important that you have good, strong, robust third-party validation of your security too. The bit that I'm finding kind of frustrating right now is, and the reason I put this talk in, was that we've seen 2 years on the bounce, vendors make the same mistakes. And we started seeing it all over again in the last month. Do people not learn? This is the BC Vault, which is another crypto wallet. And they announced a 24-hour million-dollar bug bounty program that they didn't really announce very well. And no one could be bothered to participate, because $1 million and 24 hours is not enough time to compromise a device. You need months of time to compromise these things properly. But they still went and made a claim. Hey, no one's claimed the bounty, so it must be 100% secure. And this happened very recently, in the last week. The Impulse K1, kind of cell phone, kind of crypto wallet, they announced a one-day, million-dollar hack tournament. Come and hack our device. Didn't really promote it very much. Didn't get out there very far. And they made a claim, because no one had participated and succeeded at winning the prize, therefore it was unhackable. Guess what? Inside, MediaTek MTK6762. Not the right platform to be building a good crypto wallet on. How did nobody learn from the train wreck that was Bitfi? And we're still seeing this over and over again, which is a real shame. And I'm going to leave you with a quote from Ryan Castellucci, one of the guys who was on the team. And I think this is actually really quite deep, is hacking, pen testing, security research. It's about understanding components of systems better than the people who built them. And using that knowledge to think outside the thought process they had and doing what they considered to be impossible by approaching a problem from a different angle. And that is hacking to me. So to conclude, by and large, most security researchers are trying to make things better. They're trying to do the right thing, then trying to uncover poor behavior, and they're trying to help organizations get better. So I strongly recommend if a researcher does make contact, embrace them, thank them. If you don't have a bug bounty program, think about setting them up. Send them some swag. Say thank you. Acknowledge. That's all it takes to get a researcher on site. Because if you don't and start denying what they're saying to you, we're going to see the fun of the Streisand effect. And that's exactly what happened with Bitfi. Barbara Streisand tried to suppress photographs of her mansion. What actually happened? It became a press story. It went viral, which is exactly what happened with Bitfi. Acknowledge, embrace, cooperate, coordinate, and you're going to come out of it looking really, really good. No one can be perfect, but you can respond perfectly. Thanks very much. I hope you found that useful. We blog about this, embedded system security, all the time. It's on there. If you need any help with embedded system security, I hope you know where to come. Thank you so much. So we have some time for questions, please.
Yes, good morning. Which is, in your opinion, the most secure cold storage wallet so far?
So I think there's a lot to be said for Trezor and Ledger. And what I like about them is that they embrace security research. They didn't try and keep it quiet, and they take action. So they're actually on with research that's been done. They've worked really well, so I'm super pleased. I really like Ledger and Trezor. Are they perfect? No, but I think they're certainly ahead of the curve.
Thanks.
Thank you. Any more questions there? One here. Yeah, you're absolutely right. That's a really good point I didn't make very clear. So we still see the word unhackable used quite frequently, and it always gets our attention, whether another researcher has seen it and passed it on to us going, hey, you're the guys who do unhackable, right? It was the word unhackable that really got our attention, yes. Because it's the challenge, right? It's like, you know, here is a flag. Here's a target. Yeah, let's go for it. Let's see what we can do. So that's why I think that word is particularly sensitive, and it was what caught our attention, yes. Any more questions? Great. Thank you very much. I think the slides are online. Thank you.